kasama siya, mga relatives niya pala. Political regimes. Again, what's his name? The first one, President Tobacco Boy. Ramos. The Tobacco Boy. Ramos. Ganyan din, marami din mga accusations of corruption. Walang change. Third, si Estrada. More. Plunder. Fourth, si Gloria. Buti naman Supreme Court absolved her because of lack of evidence. Pero, the mud was thrown on the wall against Gloria and she has to live through that mud. Corruption charges. Balibig ba siya sa bayani? I don't know. Many of the people buried in bayani, in the Bolivian bayani, are not heroes. They were soldiers and officials of President Marcos. Marami doon. So, bayanis and Marcos loyalists are buried together there. If I were to go, I would just simply call it Libingan ng mga presidente at mga bayani. Tapos, you can put anybody there. Alright. Unsolicited advice. The economic situation the same. As I mentioned here today, social injustices create the gap between rich and poor. The dominance of economic families, tignan natin, the top 50 families, both in politics and in economics, they are together. They control the economy. Billionaires. Some of them are very charitable, generous, like the C family. They have a foundation for poor parishes, foundation the C family. Lucian, I'm not too sure. Maybe they have also something. Avoidis, the Ayala Foundation. Lahat-lahat ng mga ganyan. Many of them are Spanish descent and others are Chinese descent. Wala yung Pilipino ta Pilipino ta. Why? I do not know. The dominance of economic, exclusive economic growth and development. Kasi, yung development natin favors the elite and the powerful. Sila man lang ang nag-develop ng economic plan. Economic plan. And the economic plan favors industries, capital ventures, hindi from the bottom up. And the bishops of the Philippines also wrote a pastoral letter to prepare for the third millennium of the economic situation in the Philippines. And the name of that economic exhortation is development with a human face. Development must be from the bottom up, not trickle down, from the bottom up, starting with the poor people. I think Tingkong is interested in that. An option for the poor. Economic Darwinism at the global at local levels. What do you mean by that? Survival of the fittest. Globalization is survival of the fittest. That's global economic globalization. Take away all regulations or liberalization. Liberalize everything. No? Liberalize everything. Free markets. And in the free market, yung small fish cannot survive. The big conglomerates, SM, Robinson, Daisano, lahat yan, they take over the small businesses. And not only that, it is in agriculture. The small farms cannot compete with agribusiness, plantations everywhere. No? So they are forced to sell or to lease their land to the the big agribusiness capitalists. You know, problem, plantation, palm oil, pinya. What is pinya? Pineapple, banana, lahat-lahat yan. All over, even Maguindanao is being African oil, African palm oil. Ewan ko bakit African. Red man yung fruit. Anyway, so revival of the fittest, the alliance between the rich and the powerful. What I mean by powerful are the politicians, and the rich are the economists, capitalists. They are in cahoots. Who is a poor man who can aspire to become president of the Philippines? No, he has to have a backer, and the backer must be a millionaire. Ambivalence of cultural values, reinforcing political and economic imbalances. Family-centeredness is part, probably is both bad and good. Family-centeredness, you sacrifice for the family. OFWs, examples of that. Family-centeredness. But there is also family-centeredness that is bad. When somebody commits corruption, it is corruption for his family, to enrich his family, his own vested narrow interests. That's part of it. And then another attitude, bahala na. As long as I survive, okay lang sila. They do not touch my life. The big shots. Dito lang kami. We are living in peace. Bahala ng Diyos, that is also bad value. The value of survival must be a value of striving and striving, striving to go against the social order that oppresses the poor people. So, narrow vested interest over a sense of the common good. No, sabi ng isang politician during the time of Magsaysay, na, what are we in power for? So we enrich ourselves. What are we in power for? If not to enrich ourselves. A culture of criminality and impunity. Criminality and impunity. Look at all the drug traffickers, pushers, that are surrendering themselves. When they were out there in the streets selling, what were the police doing? Criminality that is not punished. Criminality that is not pursued. That's another part of our cultural situation. A culture of deep religious biases and prejudices regarding Muslims. For instance, and also regarding each other. Ako'y Ilocano. When you think of Ilocanos, what word comes to your mind? Kuribod. Oh, Kuribod. Why? When you hear the word Ilonggo, what word comes to your mind? Tikalon. Tikal. Malambing ang language. Ha? As to, galit na siya, pero pag-express niya, ay, sobra ka naman. Pero, Tikalon, Tikal. Bishop Diamonte once gave a talk. I once told a story. Sabi niya, Bishop Alberto Diamonte of Haro, when he was still alive. Of course, he was still alive. He could talk. He told a story. Nag-patlak dinner, sa lunch, ang mga OFW sa Roma. Doon sila sa Termini train station. Sabi ng Tagalog, I will bring pancit malabon. Sabi ng Bicolano, I like that very much. I will bring laing, Bicol Express. And then the Bicolano said, I like that very much. What is favorite food in Yan na, people expressed. Then we have Isaya. Dilongo. Oh, I like that people express very much. I will bring parang pansit pulo. Okay, pansit taga pulo eh. Taga pulo ha. Pansit pulo. Ay, sabi ng Ilocano, I like those very, I like people express. I like pansit pulo. Pansit pulo. I will bring my relatives. And he was telling this story when we were in a bus from the going to the Vatican for a synod. Marami kami, mga 12 bishops. And they were all laughing. Kurimot ka pala. I also have a story to tell. Sabi no, there were three prisoners ready to be executed the following day. At sabi ng warden sa isa sa Tagalog, what is your last wish? For 25 years, hindi ako nakakain ng pansit malabon. 25 years, please, my last wish po, makakain ako ng pansit malabon. Granted, yung Ilongo, sir, for 25 years, diri sa priso, hindi ako naka-speech. Naka-speech. Kasi yung speech niya, tikal-tikal lang, malang. Very long speech, he'll put a microphone and he will talk for hours. All yabang-yabang, tikal. That's the stereo, ha? Stereo type lang. Kami na rin yung cause. Patupatul ko lang yan. And he said, mag-speech. Sabi ng brother, granted. Look, ano naman? Ano yung last wish? Ang last wish ko po ay to be executed before the Ilongo gives his speech. Maya says, prejudices, no, looking down at people. Ganyan din, but especially against Muslims. Group, ang Tagalog nila sa Mindanao. Group, yung disiplina, my driver is Filipino. Of the record. We would go through Muslim area 1 hour, 2 hours through going to the south. And we would go every town, my dogs are crossing the street, people are going to the street, we are looking left and right. Sabi ng driver ko, wala silang disiplina. They could look left and right, they stop anywhere in the street. Pagdating namin sa Isulan, which is a Christian area, no? The same thing is happening. Sabi ko sa driver ko, uy, ato is his name. Kasi niya yung pato. Ako, marami siguro Muslim drivers dito. Sabi niya, mga Kristiyano sila lahat ni siya. Kung wala silang disiplina eh. Tawa lang siya. He gets the point. He laughs. But the next time we pass through that same area, the Muslim, ganyan pa rin. Maraming Muslim drivers stop. Kiyapo, siya kiyapo. Everybody's day, there's crossing and all that. No? But they are Christians. But that is the stereotype. What biases against Muslims. Okay. But then, basically to take the right of place. We look at the situation, and then we said to ourselves, this is the situation that we are in now. We have failed to evangelize. We only sacramentalize. We give them the sacraments, but we have not taught them the faith, so that the faith will be lived. We have to renew the church. We have to renew the way we evangelize people. And that is the situation that we are looking at, the political, economic, and cultural. Ganyan ang nangyari sa PCP2. A Pentecost for the church in the Philippines. Pentecost, the Holy Spirit coming down, renewing the church, giving them courage, the disciples, apostles, Blessed Mother in the midst, and then they went out with great courage to evangelize, renewing not only the community of faith from fear and timidity to courage and public witness. Renewed. And then they went out on mission. A Pentecost for the church in the Philippines. You look at the Acts and decrees of the ACP2. And you will see there was a bishop who was very much involved, and he said to me one time, the more I read the Acts and decrees, especially the text, the more he finds the richness of it, the vibrancy of a faith that is being expressed. The overarching question to embark or renew the integral evangelization, what kind of church should we be? We wanted to envision the church that we should be in order to evangelize credibly and effectively, not sacramentalize. Renewed integral evangelization, therefore. Integral mission. What is this integral evangelization? Integral evangelization is what Paul the Sixth said in Evangelii Nuntiandi. Once upon a time, Evangelii Nuntiandi, proclaiming the church in the modern world, Pope Paul the Sixth, that document was once called the Magna Carta of Catechists. It's good to review that. In conjunction with Evangelii Gaudium. Evangelii Nuntiandi, announcing the gospel, Evangelii Gaudium, Pope Francis, that's pro-joy. Nawala siya. Okay, proclaiming, it is both proclaiming the spiritual salvation, but as well as temporal liberation. It is salvation from everything that oppresses the human being, especially sin, but also liberation that oppresses the human being, like ignorance, sickness, disease. That's why when Jesus evangelized, proclaimed the gospel, he not only said, "You are forgiven," but he would also say, go, your faith has saved you, walk. I've not been walking for since birth, and the Lord Jesus tells me, walk, and I can walk, hindi lang walk lang, jumping up for joy, love to, Ilocano, Ilocano. Sometimes when I preach Ilocano in Ilocos Noon, I use Ilocano words because I forget the Ilocano words, and sabi nila, malalim yung Ilocano niya. Malalim. Action for justice. This is what is important. The Synod of Bishops on Justice in the World said, to participate in transformation of the world, to act for justice is part and parcel of the gospel. Kaya in the gospel, you have what we call the social dimension of the gospel. So when you do this, you combine the social gospel of the gospel of the church and the spiritual message of the Lord Jesus, that is what you call integral gospel, integral evangelization, and when you proclaim both of them together. Integral liberation. See also Evangelii Gaudium, the social dimension of the gospel of joy. But in PCP2, to renew the church means renewed catechesis. Ayan, renewed catechesis. Renewed liturgy, renewed social action. Those three are part and parcel of the renewal of the church from PCP2. You have to renew catechesis. We have to renew the liturgy. We have to renew social action. After PCP2, dami, mga diocesan synods were being done, diocesan pastoral assemblies. So many of us were being invited to talk in different dioceses to explain to them what PCP2 said about integral evangelization and what dioceses should do to renew their own structures and to renew their own dioceses. Synod after synods of dioceses and the pastoral assemblies were done all over the Philippines. There was a spirit of renewal that was warm and that was followed enthusiastically. Pero after several years, parang ganyan, like the Concilio movement in the past. Going up, soaring high, and then crash landing. Hindi naman crash landing, parang nag-land and we sleep lang. Dormant. So, after 10 years, the National Pastoral Consultation and Church Renewal took place to evaluate what has taken place in the past 10 years, from 1991 to 2001. National Pastoral Consultation. And it is there to help the bishops renew the spirit of Pentecost at PCP2, from PCP2, to revive it, to make it easier for dioceses to implement, to realize the vision for church. The 9 major pastoral priorities were formulated. The 9 major pastoral priorities. This is what we are doing now when we are preparing for the 500th year of Christianity. Mayor Kailan,
every time, 1521,
I hear the voice, Mother, I am sick. Call the doctor very quick. That is the one of Magellan. He was hit by the sword, by the spear of Lapu-Lapu. He go in Cebu, gave a speech, saying, he has his dirty language, no? Mga Tagalog, mga imperialista ang mga Tagalog. Bakit? Jose Rizal, Bonifacio, Papini, Tagalog sila lahat. Pero dapat the first national hero natin ay binigyan ng pangalan ng sa isda. Lapu-lapu, kinakain lang. Pero kung ako ang maging presente, blablabla, mga Tagalog na imperialista na yan, national holiday, national hero, Lapu-lapu. Iba na yung isda. We will call it Katipunero. Sa akin na yan. Pero ganyan. Lapu-lapu. Well, he hit Magellan with his spear. Magellan began singing, Mother, I am sick. Call the doctor very quick. Sabi ni Yoyoy Union. Okay. Look at that. The first year of preparation for the 900th, the first major priority. Year of faith. Year of integral faith. Malaki ang role, papel ng mga katikista, mga lay leaders regarding this. Renewing the faith, integral faith. Year of the laity, year of the poor, year of the family, and the Eucharist. Ngayon yan, di ba? Year of the family, and the Eucharist. Year of the parish, next year, as a participatory community. Year of the parish. Year of PECs and other movements to renew parish communities. What we are trying to do, to prepare for the 500 years, is to rekindle the spirit of renewal, rekindle the Pentecostal fire of renewal sa PCP too. And that's the reason for year after year, a major pastoral priority is selected as the focus of that year. What is our vision? If we are striving towards renewal, what is the vision of church? What kind of church should we be? And we see to lay out five important dimensions of the vision of church that we should be. One, that we should be authentic disciples in word and deed. Authentic discipleship of the faith community. In word and in deed, itong problema natin, many are baptized and few are active in the faith, with their faith. They forget the faith. We now live, according to the famous psychologist Father Byron Boletau, in a split-level Christianity. Split-level Christianity. We live our Christianity at one level, at the other level, compartment, not united, is our daily life. Our daily life is one that is not very Christian. But our faith is Christian. Word separated from deed. If the country is corrupt and we are 80% Catholic in this country, most of our politicians would be what? Catholic. Graduates of Catholic schools. Graduates. One Muslim bishop told me in Indonesia, and a Muslim bishop, one Indonesian bishop in there told me, you know, bishop, I wish that the Philippines, the only Christian country in the Asia, would be a model of Christianity. Pero sabi niya, but the Philippines is as poor as Indonesia and as corrupt as Indonesia. So, mahirap masabi, ito, it's not very good to you. You are proud to be a Christian country. Naimik lang ako. Napahi ako. So, I could not say anything. Totoo man yun. Countersign. Split level Christian. Authentic community. Authentic community is a community of people united in mind and heart. Like the first Christians. United in mind and heart. Even though there are differences, they do not kill one another with their differences. Dito, there are political divisions. There are economic divisions. People are being killed in those divisions. There are religious divisions. Here on television, one group, one sect, one cult, born again cult, speaks against another cult. Did I just hear the Soriano at Iglesia ni Cristo? Pero they turn around and fight common enemy, the church, including the highest alumnus of our Notre Dame schools in Cotabato. The highest alumnus is not a cardinal, is not a bishop, is not a congressman, is not a governor. The highest alumnus of our Catholic schools called Notre Dame in Cotabato and Sulu is the appointed son of God. If I meet him, I will have to kneel down and say, oh, son of God. Sino yon? Tibuloy. Friend of President Digo. The advisor of President Digo. The other advisor is Archbishop Buloy. Well, yes. So, combination is Kim Buloy. By the way, some of these are off the record. Some of these are off the record. Si Sister Jess mag-edit. Okay. This countersign to the divisions and conflicts in our society, an authentic community of disciples against the divisions, religious, political, economic in society. Inculturated faith, a third dimension of the mission of church. Inculturated faith, integral faith. Immersed in Filipino culture, our faith, and it's true, we are immersed in, our faith is expressed through our Filipino culture. The way we worship is different from the way Chinese worship. Yeah. Punta tayo sa misa, Allah, gitara-gitara. Sometimes clapping, if you do that in China, if you do that in Thailand, di pwede. Very quiet. In Korea, may veils pa sila, mga women. Naka-veil pa sila, and quiet. Hands joined like this, kneeling down, solid. Parang nasa talagang in front of Jesus. A transcendent one. Pero kita, ang tawag natin kay Jesus is bro. Bro. Iligan mo lang kay bro, ha? Bro, ha? Na bro. That's why, mamasabano, the place, mamasabano, the massacre in Sharif Atwan, yung Atwan versus Pagoda Kato. I passed through that area 2 days after the massacre, and I stopped to go to the massacre site, and the capitan, graduate of bagong graduate ng BMA, said, Archbishop, di pwede dun, delikado dun, 2 kilometers away from the highway, delikado dun, kailan ko, kasi delikado, tara ko, gabi na, next time, okay, next time. Pero sabi niya, Bishop, may rosary siya eh. At yung mga katawan, kasama niya, tawan, eh may mga rosary sa mga guns nila. Sir, tawag ka Bishop, i-pray mo na lang kami kay bro. Oh, sige, kay Lord natin, Jesus. So parang familiar tayo, our relationship with Jesus. Parang brother, friend, hindi yung God in the distance. Familiar. Kaya ang ating simbahan, noisy. All cell phones are open. Tapos yung pari, sabi niya, all cell phones should be closed. Pag consecration time, na-green yung kanyang cell phone. Oh, sorry, the Lord is calling me. Purifying Filipino culture from within. Our faith is immersed in Filipino culture, enriched by that culture, and it is also purifying the Filipino culture from within. Yan ang inculturation. Inculturation. But, now you can see, ang isang plano ninyo, isang programa ninyo is the revision of the Catechism of Filipino Catholic, CFC. Okay. Now you can see the importance and the relevance of that catechism in our culture. Kasi it is the universal catechism of the Church, contextualized and enculturated dito sa atin, expressed in our own, expressing our own language of faith. Now, when you look at that, parang you are putting together the documents of the Church, Vatican II, Evangelii Nuntiandi, Evangelii Gaudium, all those are to be expressed in that, in our Filipino culture. Participatory Church, the fourth dimension. The fourth dimension, participatory Church. Ito is, there was a word that was used. We use it in the text. Igulang na ako, nalimutan ko na. But it was questioned by the lay people, and I had to explain what that word meant. It is not to empowering the faithful. It's not giving them power that was not there. No, empowering the faithful means activating the charisms that they have received in baptism, in confirmation, in the Eucharist, or in marriage, to activate their charism, the gift of God that was given to them through the sacraments, so that they become active participants in the Church and in the mission of the Church. How often do you see, how do you contribute to the mission of the Church? Collection. Ika is a collection. Diba? They don't even know that that money is for the mission of the Church. Akala nila para sa pari yun. Collection. No. The poor, at this time, that is the only way of their contribution to the mission of the Church, by giving to the collection. Pero, it is more than that. To activate the charisms in baptism and confirmation means that they not only participate through collection, but by through other means. Other means like whatever forms of support. Modified tithing. Or even from catechesis, becoming catechists, lay family leaders, mga youth leaders. These are activating the charism. They are being empowered to do mission. And many are there who are volunteer missionaries. Kurumbans are training volunteer missionaries to go abroad. Lay people, husbands and wives, volunteers of the Jesuits, they go abroad. And one of them was killed somewhere in Asia, martyr, including the Jesuit scholastic, I think. Volunteers. These are participants. This is the part of a participatory Church. But you see, especially those in movements of renewal, what they used to call transparential communities. The elders nila. Okay. Or in the BEC movement, mga kaabags, all the people there, members of the BEC, they participate in church events, in church affairs, and in church mission. So, there is need. Towards a participatory Church, there is need for the renewal of the laity. Towards taking leadership in church ministries. My favorite color, blue, light blue. My room has blue. For any comfort room. Joke lang yung siyan. Renewal of consecrated life. Towards a participatory Church, the consecrated life according to PCP2 must be renewed in order that they be true, authentic prophets in action. prophets within the church, they have to show the holiness of the church to the church. They are also prophets in society, because their community life is a countersign to the divisions in the wider society. Their community life. But if their community life is divisive, fighting one another in the community, they are not a countersign. They are not prophets for society. The poverty that they need should point the poverty of each individual consecrated person is also a countersign of the greed and the massive poverty of people. Again, renewal of the clergy towards servant leadership, ito ang kailangan. Ito ang kailangan. Without the bishop and without priests, walang mangyari. That is the culture of the Philippines. Kultus, sabi ni Bishop Makani noon, kultus hari, kultus hari, kultus hari. Depends on the priests. So my first assignment to the priest during pastoral assembly, the first pastoral assembly in Vigan, was to change the attitude of priests and sisters and lay people. When you go to that workshop, I told the priest, when you go to your workshop, keep quiet. The people will ask you to answer questions. Keep quiet. Let them talk about that question. The first workshop was difficult. Everybody was keeping quiet. Because the lay people were asking the priest, and the priest said, no, sabi ng obispo, tayong lahat mag-discuss yan. Of course, I have my own opinion about it, but I'm not going to tell you, and then you follow it. Let us discuss what is the best. So they began the second workshop na lahat. Free for all na lahat. Hindi na makapasok yung pare. Pero, participatory. The priest is becoming to be a servant who listens, who consults, who does not dictate. It is the master who dictates, not the servant. Yeah, again. So a change of priest from monarchical, hierarchical, to participatory, consultative, collaborative. Yan ang importante. Renewal of the clergy. It is slower process of making decision, pero it's more fruitful, more effective. Renewal of the clergy towards servant leadership. Church of the poor. This is the most formidable and most difficult section of the vision of the church. Why? We have an image in the Philippines of a church that is in the side of the elite and powerful. We have an image of richness in the hierarchy and in the priesthood and in consecrated life. I once gave a talk on evangelization to the Assembly of Religious Treasurers. Maybe 150 religious treasurers. Treasurers of the RBN, treasurer of Charles Carlos Borromeo, Franciscans, Dominicans, and yeah. And I asked, if you are a religious treasurer, how much do you think is the investment of your congregation investment? Okay. And that investment is for purposes of the mission. It's not for the congregation itself, but it's for the mission of the congregation to run schools, to run orphanages, and all that. It is not meant to accumulate riches. So they invest ethically in certain things that are not unethical. It is not good to invest in in a pharmaceutical company that produces condoms and contraceptives. That's not ethical. It's not ethical to invest your money in companies that produce weapons. It's not good to invest in people who raise money for smuggling. Malaki ang return, pero it's not ethical. So, religious congregations, I mentioned that altogether, all the religious institutions, from the poorest to the richest, would have an investment that is equal to the national budget, billions of pesos. How then do you counteract the image of richness in the church? Sabi ng mga isay, yung mga golden chalices and siguria ninyo, mga monstrances ninyo, ibaligyan nyo para sa poor people. It's the same complaint that the Pharisee had with regard to the poor.